गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल ऑफ यू। टुडेज टॉपिक इज नेटवर्क एनालिसिस इन जीआईएस। इट इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एज फार एज द जीआईएस इज कंसर्न। एंड फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी विल ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज अ नेटवर्क एंड देन डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम एसोसिएटेड विद द नेटवर्क। सो इफ वी डिस्कस अबाउट द ग्राफ थ्योरेटिकली, सो इन ग्राफ थ्योरी द नेटवर्क कैन बी डिफाइंड एज ए सेट ऑफ वर्टिसेस एंड एजेस। So basically, in general, the network is a system of interconnected features, particularly the point and line features. Now, polygon features take part in the constructions of the network. So network is basically a system of point and line features through which the resources flow. The flow of resources is also a very important attribute of the network, or the communication is achieved, and this whole of the network is representing some geographic phenomena. For example, it may be some road network, or it may be canal network, or it may be transmission line network, and so on. So it should represent some graphical phenomena, otherwise there is no significance of the network. So a graph, in graph theory, it can be defined as a set of vertices and set of the edges. Here you can see, here V is a set of vertices, not a single vertex. Similarly, the E is a set of edges, not a single edge. So you can say network is a collection of the nodes and edges or arcs or line features. Here we can see different types of the examples of the networks are given. If you talk about this, so this is a simple network, and there are four types of the attributes of the network. One is called the connectivity, another one is called the weight of the networks, and third one is called the planarity of the network, and fourth one is called the direction of flow of resources over the line or point features. So there are four attributes of the network. So depending upon these four attributes, we can categorize all types of the networks into four categories. Here you can see all these line features are connected with each other. Here all these line and point features are there. All these are connected, but these two additional features are not connected with the original body of the network. So there is a slight difference from here to here. Here all these features are connected. Here few features are not connected. And we go from here to here. Then in the third example, the point features are there, line features are there, all are connected. In addition to these two things, the direction of flow of resources by arrows is also mentioned. And in from third to fourth, in the fourth example, line features and point features are there, all are connected, lying in a single plane. And there is a direction of flow of resources is also mentioned, and the weight of each and every individual line is also mentioned. So from here to here, we can say this is only a connected network. No weights are assigned to each and every line, so it is called the unweighted network. All these point line features are lying in a single plane, so you can say this is the planar network, and direction of flow of resources is not there, so you can say this is the undirected network. Similarly, here this is the disconnected network, because these two features are not connected with this one, so this is the disconnected network, and weights are not there, so unweighted network. All features are lying in a single plane, so you can say this is a planar network. Direction of flow of resources is not there, so it is undirected network. Similarly, here this is the connected, unweighted, planar, and directed network, and this one is connected network, weighted network, planar, and directed network. Here all types of the things are there. All these line and point features lying in a single plane, all are connected, weights are there, flow of resources is also there. So depending upon these things, we can categorize these four types of the networks. One is called the connected versus disconnected graphs or networks, directed versus undirected networks or graphs, planar versus non-planar. Non-planar in the sense, if all these features are not lying in a single plane, suppose some of the features are lying in a one elevation or in a one plane, some features are lying in another plane, so there are more than one planes, then you can say the graph is non-planar network. So this is weighted network and unweighted network. So if weights are there, then it is weighted, otherwise unweighted network. But this number, this is, you see here, from for this particular edge, this number is 5. This 5 is nothing but the weight. This weight is very important factor for a network analysis. This number may represent some transportation cost from this place to this place. So at here you can say this is a very simple example, and the number is very simple, but to define this number is very difficult. You cannot define directly 5 or 6 or 8 and so on. This number has some significance. This also is related with the network. For example, this number may represent the distance, travel distance from this node to this node. So this may vary from here to here, here to here, or here to here. So this is, or you can say the transportation cost, you can calculate in terms of the transportation travel distance from one node to another node, or you can say on a particular line feature. So this number may represent the travel distance, or this number may represent the travel time also from here to here, or this number may represent any other factor which is directly or indirectly responsible for the transportation cost from here to here. So the meaning or the significance of this number is very, very difficult, and the definition of it is also difficult, because this number you can define in the context in which you are using. You are using only distance as a impedance, or distance as a cost factor, or distance as a weight function, then you can write simply the number or travel distance from here to here. If you are measuring this transportation cost from here to here in terms of the travel distance, then the unit of this number is the distance, unit of the distance. If you are measuring the transportation cost from here to here in terms of the travel time, then this 5 may be the travel time, and this the unit of this time, the unit of this impedance factor may be the unit of the time, that may be the minutes, seconds, or hours, and so on. So here I have written the name, different names of this particular weight function. This is commonly known as the weight function. It may also known as the cost function or cost factor, or in GIS we will call it the impedance factor. So impedance factor is nothing but the weight from one line, one point to another point, or one vertex to another vertex, or you can say for a arc or edge. So the importance, this number has a great importance in the network analysis. And here I have written down this two things. The features, only the point and line features takes part in the network analysis. No polygon features takes part in the network analysis. And resources means this anything which is moving on the line features, that is called the resources. For example, if you are talking about this transportation network or road network, then these buses or traffic you can consider as the resources. If you are talking about the transmission line network, then the electricity you can consider as the resources. In canal network, the water may be a resources, and so on. Here I have explained all these things with the help of the graph theory. Then there is need to understand what is the similarity from these graphs and the GIS. So the similarity is, in graph theory, all these graphs you can represent in the form of the point and line features, and these point and line features you can digitize very easily in GIS, because in GIS vector data is in the form of the point, line, and polygons. So you can digitize all these point and line features very easily in the GIS or in GIS softwares, and then you can perform the analysis very easily. And one more thing here. All these features or constituents of the network are the point and line features. The dimension of the point feature is 0 dimension, and the dimension of the line feature is the 1 dimension. So this particular line is also called the one dimensional simplex. Similarly, these point features are called the 0 dimensional features. And if you are talking about the whole network, then this network, you can say this is the one dimensional complex, because more than one lines are there, and the dimension is 1. So you can say this is the whole network is called the one dimensional complex. Then come to some network analysis and real world examples. Here you can see these are the examples related to the networks. Let us say the transmission line network, this is the pipeline network, and this railway network, canal network, river network, and the road network or highway network. So if you talk about all these networks, so these all types of the networks you can divide into two categories. One is called the transportation networks, another one is called the utility network. For example, this pipeline network comes under the category of the utility network, or this transmission line network is also under the category of the utility network. So network analysis is nothing but a process to solve the network related problems. How we can solve these problems which are related with the network, and that process is basically called the analysis. And these are the examples. Here you can see some common elements of the network. If you talk about the GIS, so these terms are very common in GIS, like the links. Links are nothing but the line features, whatever we have discussed in the graph theory. That is a basic element of the network, that is the line or link or arc or edge, all terms are same. And these are the nodes. Nodes are also called the junctions. So nodes are also the point features. And these are the turns. Turn is a very important attribute of the network in case of the GIS, because at every junction or every node, you need to define the number of the turns, whether it is the left turn or right turn or a straight way or U-turn. So all these turns you can define under this category. Another one is, another element of this network is the impedance. This is very important. That is nothing but the weight function. And this weight function is nothing but the transportation cost from one place to another place. Or in other words, you can say this transportation cost or this impedance factor is nothing but the restrictions in the flow of the resources from one location to another location. If you are moving on the road, so how much restriction is there or how much cost is there, that is represented in terms of the impedance. So this impedance may be at the turn locations, or it may be at the link locations or link or lines. So the impedance you can define for both of them, lines as well as the turns as well as the nodes. Nodes are basically point features, and turns are defined from one link to another link. And this is the resource demand. So remote resource demand is nothing but the quantity of the resources. If you are talking about the transportation network, the number of vehicles you can consider as a resource demand. If you are talking about the pipeline network, then the amount of fluid flowing into the pipeline network, that is called the resource demand. Angle basically decides the left turn or right turn or the U-turn or straight. So this you can categorize, or you can say this angle is basically the subtype or attribute of the turn element. Blocks are the some locations where the resources is not allowed to move from one location to another location. So these blocks are specific locations which prevents the movement of the resources. And facility points are the some specific point from where the resources is flowing, or the source of resource is there. For example, bus stand you can consider as a facility points or source point. Similarly, these are the stops. Stops are nothing but where the resources is picked up, or these are basically the locations from where the resources are picked up or dropped off. So these are the basic element in terms of the GIS. Here I have shown three examples of the turns. For example, first one is, suppose this is your junction, and this junction is connected with three lines, one line, another line, and another line. So this is the example showing how many possible turns are there at a particular junction which is connected with, let us say, n number of links. So this junction is connected with the three lines. So total 3 square, that is 9 turns are possible at this junction. If three links are there, then 9. If 4 are there, then 16 turns are possible. So these 9 turns you can understand by this way. Suppose you are moving from here to here, then you have to take here whether this is the right turns or the straight or U-turn, correct? So if you are moving from this way, then there are three possibilities, or you can take three turns, straight, or the right turn, or U-turn. So three turns are from this side, similarly three turns from this side, and three turns from this side. So total 9 turns are there at this junction. So in general, we can say at a junction, n square turns are there if that junction is connected with n number of the links. And these two points are there. This network analysis can be performed on the raster data as well as the vector data in GIS. Here I have write down some problems related with the networks and also some applications. For example, these are very common problem based on the network. One is called this shortest path problem. This is very common problem. If you want to move from one location to another location in a city or in a district or from between two cities or more than two cities, then there is a need to find out the shortest path from one location to another location or from the origin to other destinations. So how we can find out the shortest path between two locations or n number of locations? So this is a common problem, and this is also the applications of the network. Thanks. So this, under this shortest path problem, you can also handle this driving time analysis. Means if you are moving from one location to another location, from origin to destination, so how much travel time is required? So driving time you can analyze very easily. You can find out the optimal routing. So optimal routing is somehow related with the shortest path, because this optimal in the sense the total transportation cost is minimum. Here in shortest, you can say this is shortest means this is the optimal with respect to the distance. So distance, you can say if the impedance factor you are considering as a distance, then you can say the shortest path and the optimal path both are same. And this is the closest facility analysis. This is also very important. This is useful for the emergency cases. For example, if you have in a, if you are moving in a city and randomly somewhere accident happens, so from that particular location you want to search some closest hospitals or closest police stations. So from that accident spot, random location, from that random location you can find out the closest hospitals or police stations, or in general we can say the closest facilities from that random accident spot within a certain interval of time or within certain distance, let us say 200 meter distance or 5 minutes of travel time. So depending upon your choice, you can also find out the closest facility from a random spot or from a random location. And also you can analyze the driving directions. Driving directions means if you are able to find out the shortest path from one location to another location, so that path may be zigzag or may have different number of turns from starting point to another point. So you want, or you can, in other words, we can say if you are unaware about a particular city and you are solving the problem and you are getting the shortest path from one location to another location on the map. So from that map, you are not able to identify where we have to take left turn and right turn, because there are some intermediate roads also. So these driving directions will help you to handle these types of the situations if multiple directions are there, or multiple routes are there, or multiple lines or roads are there. So under this analysis, driving directions analysis, you can define the proper movement of a passenger from one location to another location. Let us say somebody is starting from IARS, moving towards the Delhi, then he wants to move on the Kalidas road, then take left, then right, travel this much distance, this much time. So complete information you can write in the form of the text. So this text information is very important in a particular city. If let us say the city is very big or metropolitan cities, the driving direction is very important. Similarly, another important problem is a supply demand problem. Supply demand problem, this is mostly useful for the business purposes. Suppose in your city, number of distribution centers or number of factories or number of warehouses are there. So from those warehouses or those distribution centers, you want to distribute some goods or material to some actual customer locations. So question is, how we can optimize the total transportation cost from all those distribution centers to those customer locations? So this is another problem. So this is basically supply means supply locations, demand means demand locations. The supply locations you can consider the distribution centers or warehouses or factories, and demand locations are nothing but the customer locations. So this is basically the distribution problem, or the distribution of the goods or material from the supply points to the demand points. And the best examples are the TSP, that is known as the traveling salesman problem. The salesman basically does, it takes the material from some distribution centers and distribute to the individual customer locations. So this is somehow related with the supply demand problem. Similarly, the vehicle routing problem is also example or subtype of the supply demand problem. So these types of the applications are involved in the business purposes. So for business purpose, the network analysis is also important. Another one is the minimum spanning tree problem. This has some another importance. For example, in our country, most of the places are not connected with the roads. So there is need to connect all these villages through roads with a condition that the total road length should be minimum. Because in first phase, governments want to connect all these villages through roads, and the expenditure should be minimum as possible. Or simply we can say we want to connect all these villages through minimum road length. So how we can connect all these villages? So these types of the problem you can handle very easily with the help of this minimum spanning tree problem. So this is one example of the minimum spanning tree problem. Another example may be like in your house, number of light points are there. Now let us say you want to connect all these light points through wire, and one main switch is there. So from main switch you want to connect all these light points. So how we can, in what configuration you want to connect so that the total wire length is minimum? So these types of the problem you can handle easily with the help of the minimum spanning tree problem. We will discuss this again in detail. And another example is the Chinese postman problem. This is also a very important problem, because the objective of this postman is he wants to move from some post offices, and he delivers the letters to each and every individual houses, and finally comes back to the post office. So he wants to travel each and every street in the house, in the city, so and keeps in mind the total travel distance is minimum. So and objective is fulfilled. So how we can plan a route for the postman so that the total travel distance or travel time is minimum? This is another important problem. And another application of this problem may be, suppose in any city there are so many garbage places or solid waste are there. If you want to recollect all these solid waste through some vehicles, and they want to go each and every place, and they collect this garbage and finally reach to the dump location. So they planned all these streets in such a way so that the total travel distance is minimum. So these types of the situation you can also handle with the help of the Chinese postman problem. The one question is here, why this is called the Chinese postman problem? This is why, because this Chinese postman problem first of all found in the Chinese journal. So some Chinese scientist has solved these types of the problem, and the same thing was published in Chinese journal. So from there it is, the name is there, the Chinese postman problem. Another example is the maximum flow problem. So maximum flow problem, with the help of this problem you can easily identify, or easily you can divert the traffic within a city. Suppose one source point is there, or number of incoming vehicles are coming at a single source, or only single entry is there in the city, and number of vehicles are there at a single entry, then how we can divert the traffic into the city so that the maximum flow is there and no jam situation is there and low congestion is there and the maximum flow is there, and finally they can reach to the destination. So another example of network problem is this one, maximum flow problem. So these types of the problem, like how we can manage all this traffic within the city, so these types of the problem you can handle with the help of the maximum flow problem. Now let us come to the first problem, that is shortest path problem. So first let us understand what is the path and what is the shortest path. So path is nothing but a sequence of nodes. Suppose you want, let us say this is a network, you want to move from here to here. So many paths are there, you can move from here to here, or you can go from here to here and then from here to here, or here to here, then here to here, and then here to here. So many paths are there. So path is basically the sequence of nodes, means from here to here, means from 1 to 2, or from S node to Y node, then from Y to T node, then T to X node. So this is basically the sequence of nodes. So path is nothing but a sequence of nodes in a graph or in a network. So this is a sequence of nodes or point features or junctions, you can say. and the shortest path is a type of the path of minimum impedance. The shortest path is nothing but a path of the minimum impedance from origin to the destination. So destination and starting point or origin may be different for different cases. Now question is, how we can find out the shortest path between two locations for a given graph? So let us discuss this one. So to find out the shortest path from one location to another location, there is an algorithm. Different algorithms are there. Very rudimentary algorithm is Disastra algorithm. So according to this algorithm, you can find out the shortest path between two locations very easily. This example is also very simple. So this according to this algorithm, it says, first of all, you decide your origin and destination. So let us say our origin in this graph, let us say the origin is this one, that is S node, and other nodes are these nodes are other, or you can say, let us say the destination is this one, X node is the destination. So we want to calculate the shortest path from S node to X node. So which one is the shortest path, and from here to here, so many paths are there. So from those possible paths, we want to extract a particular path having the minimum weight. So we can not find directly. If you want to find out the direct path from here to here, then you can use the Disastra algorithm. So according to this algorithm, there are 2-3 steps of this algorithm. Its first step is, you decide your origin and destination. Let us say S is our origin and X is our destination. And it says, then give the weight of starting node as 0 and the weight of other vertices as infinity. So this weight is infinity, this weight is infinity, infinity and infinity. So the other nodes having the infinity weight and the starting node is having 0 weight. Then it says, from this starting node, you try to search the possible paths. Let us say, from here you can move towards this way, or you can move towards this way, because you cannot move towards this way because on this particular road, the arrow is from here to here, not here to here. It shows the movement is allowed from here to here only, not from here to here. So from 0 node or this S node, you can move towards T node, or you can move towards Y node. So basically, there are two possibilities to move ahead from node number S. So let us say, move in both the directions. And in this algorithm, our effort is, initially we are assuming the weight of other vertices as infinity, and then using this algorithm, our effort is to minimize these weights as much as possible. So initially these weights are infinity, now we will try to minimize these weights as much as possible. So again, start from vertex number this. So two possibilities are there, towards T node or towards Y node. So the according to this node, this path, the weight of T node should be 0 plus 10, because 10 is the weight of this line and 0 is the weight of this node. So if you are moving towards this way, it means the weight of T node should be 0 plus 10, that is 10. The weight of T should be 10, not infinity. 10, infinity means very large weight, 10 means less than infinity. So we are interested in the less weight, so we can update this infinity by 10, because 10 is the 0 plus 10. So the weight of T vertex should be 10. So here we have updated this infinity by 10. So from here to here, that is 10. Again, from this, for this possibility, the weight of Y vertex would be 0 plus 5, that is 5. So 5 is again less than infinity. If it is less than infinity, then we will update. Otherwise, we will not update. So this 5 is less than infinity. So we will update this infinity by 5. So now the weight of T vertex and Y vertex are 10 and 5 respectively. Now in next slide, see, the weight of T vertex is 10, earlier it was 10, and the weight of this Y vertex is 5. Now the weight of T vertex is 10 according to this way. If you are moving from S to T directly, then the weight of T is 10. If you are moving from S to Y, then Y to T, then the weight of T is 8, because 5 is here, and if you are moving towards this way, then the weight of this line is 3. So 5 plus 3 is 8. So the 8 is less than 10, so we can again update this 10 by 8. So now the weight of T vertex is 8, not 10, because 10, 8 is less than 10, so we are not interested in 10, we are interested in 8. And again from vertex number Y, there are other possibilities. You can move towards this way or you can move towards this way. If you are moving towards this way, then you are reaching at vertex number Z. The weight of Z vertex, initially it was infinity, but if you are moving towards this way, then according to this way, the weight of Z should be 5 plus 2, that is 7, and 7 is always less than infinity, so we can update this infinity by 7. So the weight of Z is 7, and then if you are moving towards this way, then the weight of X is 5 plus 9, that is 14. So 14 is again less than infinity, so we can update infinity by 14. And let us again try to minimize these weights if any possibility is there. So all the possibilities are from this vertex are over. Now go to this vertex. If you are moving from Z vertex to X vertex through this way, then the weight of X should be 7 is here and 6 is this one. So total is 13, and initially earlier it was 14. So the 13 is less than 14. So we can update this 14 by 13 and we will cancel this particular root. So this is wrong. Not wrong, because we are trying to minimize the weights. So the if you are moving through this way, this weight is not minimum. If you are moving through this way, then the weight of X is minimum. So we will remove this one and we will add this way. Again from here to here, if you are moving from T to this way, so the weight of X should be 8 plus 1, that is 9, and 9 is again less than 13. So we will again delete this H, because the weight of X is 9 through this way. So it means the 9 is minimum as compared to 13, 14 or infinity. So this 9 is the minimum weight of X, 8 is the minimum weight of T, and 5 is the minimum weight of Y, and Z is the 7 is the minimum weight of Z. So this is your final output. Now this is the minimum weight, minimum and minimum weight. Earlier the weight of these vertices were infinity, infinity, infinity. Now this is the situation where you can say these vertices are having minimum weights. So our effort, our objective is complete. Our objective was this one, ki how we can minimize the weights from infinity to as small as possible for these vertices. So now these are the minimum weights. Now we can easily find out the path from given location to another location. Let us say the path from S vertex to X vertex, so the path is from 0 to Y, or S to Y, then Y to T, then T to X. So this is the path or shortest path from S vertex to T vertex, and total transportation cost is 9, because the weight of X is 9. Similarly, you can find out the shortest path from S to Z. So shortest path is from S to Y, then Y to Z, and total transportation cost is 7. So with the help of this one, you can easily identify the shortest path from one location to another location. So there are 2-3 things. Here I have written down to 4 situations. For example, from a given source origin to a given destination. Origin and destinations are fixed, then you can easily find out the shortest path. For this particular discussion, our source is fixed and destinations are also fixed. So if you want to find out the shortest path from given source or fixed source to a fixed destination, then the shortest path is fixed and you are able to find out that particular path. And similarly, if this destination is not fixed but origin is fixed, that is another situation. From a given source or given origin to any destination, means your destination is not fixed but origin is fixed or source is fixed, then you are also able to find out the shortest path from this source to the individual other locations. For example, from let us say S to T, the shortest path is not this one, S to T. The shortest path is from S to Y, then Y to T. This is the shortest path, and the total transportation cost is this one. So from a given source, you can find out the shortest path for any destination. So these 2 things you can handle with the help of Disqustra algorithm. And this third case is from any origin to a given destination. This is the case if suppose your this origin is not fixed but destination is fixed. It means what is the shortest path from Y to X or Z to X or T to X. It means your destination is fixed but origin is not fixed. Then you are not able to find out the shortest path with the help of this discussion. This discussion is basically called the forward pass of this algorithm because we are considering all these analysis along the predefined directions over the line features. Suppose the arrow is from here to here, so we have considered only the movement allowed over here to here. We are not going to discuss from here to here. So we are moving along the predefined directions. It is called the forward pass of the discussed algorithm. So with the help of the forward pass of the discussed algorithm, you can handle these two situations, first situation and second situation, but you cannot handle the third situation. Third situation is from any source to given destination, you cannot find out the shortest path with the help of the forward pass. Now, if you really want to handle this third situation, then you need to run this algorithm in backward pass also. So backward pass is nothing but you just decide your destination as a origin and your origin as a destination. You just revert the process. Here we have considered this is the origin and this is the destination and run the algorithm, that is called the forward pass. Now in backward pass, keep this as a origin and this as a destination and run the algorithm. And if you are running this algorithm in forward pass and backward pass, then you will be able to find out the solution of the third situation also. Because you are running the algorithm in backward pass, it means you are able to define the weight of each and every nodes as minimum as possible. So from here to here, let us say the minimum weight is 1. From here to here, minimum weight is somewhere. Same thing, the process is same. You can run this algorithm. So you are able to define the weights of each and every node from this given destinations. And in reverse way, you can say the shortest path, let's say from here to here, it means the weight is from here to here. So easily you can find out the shortest path from T to Z or Y to Z, X or Z to X. So there is need to run this algorithm in backward pass and forward pass to handle these first three situations. Now there is another fourth situation, means from any origin to any destination. Means your origin is not fixed and destination is also not fixed, then how we can find out the shortest path between two locations. So this is basically the real case, because in a city, number of users are there, their origins are also not fixed and destinations are not fixed. Somebody is going from X location to Y location, someone else is going from T location to Z location and so on. So this fourth case is very important. If you are able to handle this particular case, then you can also handle these first three cases. But to handle this fourth case, there you cannot handle the fourth case with the help of the forward pass or backward pass of this algorithm. To handle this one, you need to run this particular algorithm n times. If n vertices are there in the network, then you can find out the solution of the fourth situation very easily. So this is also the drawback of the discussed algorithm, because if this network is very complex, let us say 5000 or 10000 nodes or vertices are there, it means you need to run the algorithm 10000 times. If you are running the algorithm 10000 times, it means the computational time is very large. If the computational time is very large, it means you are not getting the solution quick solution you are not getting. It means this comes under the category of drawback of the discussed algorithm. To handle this situation, there is another algorithm called the Floyd's algorithm. This is slightly efficient algorithm compared to the discussed algorithm. And in this particular algorithm, the computational time is little less. So if you really want to handle this fourth situation, and then this situation you can handle easily with the help of the Floyd's algorithm as compared to discussed algorithm. But in general, if this network is not very complex, then this problem or this fourth situation you can also handle with the help of the discussed algorithm. Next one is the supply and demand problem. So this is basically, let us consider these are the set of supply nodes. Supply nodes or supply locations, or you can say these are the distribution centers or warehouses or factories and so on. Let us say this location, this location, this location, and let us say the quantity available of the material at this location is A1, quantity or material available or product available at this location are A2, and so on. Let us say this location AN. So let us say in general N supply points are there, or N factories are there, or N distributions are centers are there, And in general, let us say B demand points are there or customer locations are there. Like in this location, let us say demand is V1. This is basically the quantity, demand quantity, or this is also at this location, demand is this one, and so on. So in general, let us say N supply points are there and M demand points are there. Generally, these demand points are more than the supply points, because these are big things and these are the small things. So obviously, these number of customer locations are more than the distribution locations. And let us say this quantity, this distributor wants to distribute to these individual locations. Let us say some quantity from here to here, some quantity from here to here, and some quantity from here to here. Similarly, some quantity from here to here, here to here. So all possibilities are given. And let us say this Cij, this is the unit per unit transportation cost. Let us say per meter transportation cost or per minute transportation cost is Cij. So this is nothing but the transportation cost from ith vertex to jth vertex. So you can say this is the transportation cost of at a particular link point or line point. And this transportation cost is always greater than and equal to the zero. This transportation cost is never negative. Similarly, let us say from this supply point, Xij quantity is transported to this demand point, Xij to this point, and so on. So Xij, you can say for this particular distribution, you can say this X11 means the supply from quantity distributed from first supply point to first demand point. And let us say from X1N or 1M, it means the supply from one supply point to the mth customer location. So this basically Xi is the quantity transportation of ith supply point to jth demand point. There are two things. If you are right, these are the quantity available at all these supply points. If we add all these things, all this quantity, it means you can say this is the total supply. You can write in this form. Similarly, you can define this total demand. This means demand at all these demand locations or customer locations. So in general, if you see, sometimes this total supply is greater than total demand, and in some cases total demand is greater than total supply. That is also called the shortage situation. And in some cases this total supply is equal to the total demand. So there are three situations basically. In unbalanced problem, you can say the total supply is greater than total demand, or total demand is greater than total supply. That is called basically unbalanced problem. In case of the balanced problem, means this problem, total supply equal to total demand. If both things are satisfying, then it is called the balanced problem. Now question is, how we can determine this much quantity is transported from this location to this location? Let us say 50 ton rice is here, and the requirement is, let us say, 5 ton, 10 ton, 15 ton, something like that. Then from this particular location, how much rice is to be transported at here, and how much from here to here, and how much from here to here, with a condition that the total transportation cost is minimum. Because in all these problems, we are worrying about the transportation cost or optimal cost. We are not interested to, let us say, a maximum quantity we are transporting from here to here, which is far away, and less quantity from here to here. So our effort is, we will distribute maximum quantity from here to here, because from here to here this point is nearest. If all the demand is fulfilled, then we will go towards the next demand point. Then if all this quantity is available here, and then first we will give the preference to this distribution center, and some quantity is left, then we'll go to the farthest point. So question is, how we can determine all these distributions? So there are basically two types of the solutions. One is called the basic feasible solution. Another one is called optimal solutions. So under this basic feasible solution, the basic feasible solution means these solutions will minimize the transportation cost, but they don't guarantee that the total transportation cost will be minimum or least. But in optimal solution, the total transportation cost is minimum. They guarantee that, and that you can say that is the least transportation cost. But in these solutions or in these methods, the transportation cost is minimum. You cannot say least. there are three methods, that is the northwest corner rule, minimum cost method, penalty method, it is also called the Vogel's approximation method. And optimal solutions are stepping stone method and modified distribution method, that is also called the MODI method or UV method. But the detailed discussion I am not explaining here because it will take more time. So there is a shortage of time. So now go to this another example of this supply demand problem, let us say vehicle routing problem. So vehicle routing problem, let us consider a simple example. Let us say this one is a depot or your distribution center, or you can say this is a warehouse or in general depot, and these pink points are basically the demand locations. And at this depot location, let us say number of vehicles are there, as the name is vehicle routing problem. So number of vehicles are there, in this example 3 vehicles are there. So we need to define 3 routes, one route for each vehicle. So 3 routes are highlighted here, one route is this one, another route is this one, and another route is this one. So these are the routes for all 3 vehicles. So what is required at this particular depot, let us say the name of the depot you can write, the type of the material available at this particular depot, and what types of the material is there, and number of the vehicles are available. And also you need to define the time window for this particular depot, means for example for a service area or government offices generally opens from 9 to 5:30. So that 9 to 5:30 you can consider the time window for this particular depot, or this is also called the trip duration, and Q is basically called the quantity available at this particular depot. So now let us say different customer locations are there. Now which route so travel a particular vehicle, so we need to define the routes for each and every vehicle with a condition that the total transportation cost is minimum and the requirement of each and every customer should be satisfied. And that requirement may be with respect to the material, it means this amount of material is required at this customer location, this amount of material at this location, and so on. And also according to the time availability of the particular customer locations. So all these conditions you can handle with the help of this particular problem. Let us say if the vehicle is, first vehicle is starting from this depot and moving towards this customer location, and let us say the time window or the customer is free, or you can say this storekeeper is free at this particular time, that is here written as a P1 Q1. You can say this is the time frame, let us say 10:30 to 10:40. So 10:30 is, you can say this is a P1 and 10:40 is a Q1. So this is basically called the time window for this customer location. So the meaning of this is this particular storekeeper is free from 9:30 to 10:30. That is called the service time also. The service time is basically 10 minutes, but this is also called the time window for this particular customer location. This is the name of the customer location. This TV1 is basically called the violation time. Violation time in the sense, the time window for this particular store is 10:30 to 10:40. If suppose the vehicle is reaching at this particular location at 10:42, it means the vehicle is violating the time window of this customer location. It means some violation time has to define for this particular customer location. Let us say 5 minutes for violation time. Violation means 5 minutes relaxation time is given, or in other words we can say the vehicle can reach up to 10:45. Time window for this particular store is 9:30 to 9:40, let us say, and 5 minutes is the violation time. It means the vehicle is allowed to reach at this location at up to 9:45. So that violation time you can also define for each and every customer locations. It may vary from one customer location to another customer location depending upon their requirement. Similarly, the D1 is the demand, and this is the TS1, the service time, you can also define then the requirements of the material. So all types of the things you can handle very easily, or you can say these real time situation you can handle very easily if you are able to solve this vehicle routing problem. So suppose vehicle is moving from here to here, reaching here within this constraint and satisfying all this constraint, and then he is serving the material here, and then again moving towards another place, then another place, another place, another place, and finally coming back to the depot. So this is the complete route of the vehicle, and this route is decided in such a way that the total capacity of the vehicle is equal to or greater than the demand at these customer locations. So number of or multiple parameters are taken care here, and these types of the situation you can handle very easily. And similarly, the route for another vehicle is here, another vehicle is here. Now this one is the minimum spanning tree problem. So what is basically, first we need to understand what is the tree, and then spanning tree, and then minimum spanning tree. So tree, you can define, tree is also a graph. So that is, that graph is a connected graph. Here you can see the connected graph consisting of n nodes or n vertices and n minus 1 arcs without circuit or without loops. Or you can say a graph which is a connected in which n nodes are there and n minus 1 arcs are there, and there is no loop or no circuit, then the graph is called the tree. So for example, if you consider here, let us say from 4 to 6, then 6 to 5, this is, you can say this is a, only this one, if you extract this portion of this network, then you can say this is tree, because no circuit is there and all these three are connected, and three nodes are there from here to here and two links are there. So all these conditions are satisfied. So this is the meaning of the tree. Now spanning tree, is again a tree and again is a graph, but suppose this is a given graph. So for this particular given graph, you can draw a tree, and in that tree, all the vertices of this original graphs are there. Let us say in this graph, 5, 6 vertices are there. Now draw a tree in which all these vertices are there, for example, this one. So if all the vertices are there, then this tree is called the spanning tree. Now, if you draw individually, then there are so many spanning tree you can derive from this given graph. So many spanning tree you can derive. So it means each and every spanning tree have different weights. Weights are basically, if you are talking about this particular spanning tree, then the weight is 16 plus 11 plus 5 plus this and plus this one. So if you are able to draw or extract different spanning trees from a given graph, it means all types of the spanning trees having different weights. This minimum spanning tree is a tree having the minimum weights. So I have shown here one tree that is basically a spanning tree, and the weight of all these edges is minimum as compared to other spanning trees. So here you can see the spanning tree is a subgraph of a graph which is a tree and spans all nodes of the graphs. And minimum spanning tree is a spanning tree of the graph with minimum weights. And forest, a graph that contains no cycle, is a forest. So you can say this is also a forest, because from this spanning tree you can derive number of trees. So from this, and there is a no loop, it means this act like a forest, because from here you can extract number of trees. So from a given graph you can extract a minimum spanning tree, or from minimum spanning tree you can link with some solutions. For example, these are the locations of the villages. Let us say village number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And let us say initially these links are not there. Now you want to connect all these villages through roads with a condition that total road length is minimum. So simply what you can do, these locations are geographically located, and if your database is georeferenced, it means the location is unique. And from this location to this location, distance is also fixed. From here to here, the distance is also fixed. That distance you can consider as a weight function. And using this particular, you can drive this particular graph or network. And from that particular network, you can extract a minimum spanning tree. Let us say this one. So if you are choosing this one, it means the total length of the road is minimum and all villages are connected with each other. So, and you can also check if you are extracting another minimum spanning tree from this network, then the total length of these links will be greater than the total length of this one. So it means if you are able to extract the minimum spanning tree, then you are able to handle, or you are able to connect all these villages through minimum length of the road. But question is, if graph is given, then how we can draw this particular minimum spanning tree? Is there any method? Yes, there are two basic methods or basic algorithm. One is called the Prim's algorithm, another one is called the Kruskal's algorithm. So according to this Prim's algorithm, you can find out the tree, minimum spanning tree. Let us say this is the example of a network, this one. Nodes are from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6, total 7 nodes are there. They are connected with the lines and the weights are also given. So according to the Prim's algorithm, this algorithm says, first of all, you connect the nodes which are connected through a line having minimum length. So if you see this, these lengths or these links, the minimum weight is this one, that is 10. So first of all, connect the vertex number 0 and 5, and then from 5 and C, say 0, see the next minimum weight. Let us say from 0, another weight is 28, from 5, this weight is 25. It says, now connect the vertex number 5 to 4, because this 25 is less than 28. Don't connect 0 to 1 because weight is 28, and connect 5 to 4 because the weight is 25. It means there is a comparison between this weight and this weight, and we are interested in the lowest weight. So first connect the 5 to 4, not 0 to 1. So in the second step, we have connected this 5 to 4. Now again, see from 4, connect the 4 to other vertices or 0 to other vertices. So if you are seeing this, 4 is connected with 6 and 4 is connected with 3. So this weight is 22, this weight is 24 and this weight is 28. So among these three weights, minimum is this one, 4 to 3. So you need to connect this 4 to 3. So that is also connected this one. So we have not connected 4 to 6 or 0 to 1 because the weights are greater than these weights. Similarly, the next one is, now connect from 3 to 2 or 3 to 6, the weights are 18 and 16 and this weight is 28. So we connect the 3 to 2, that is 12, and again from 2 to 1, because this is minimum, 2 is connected with this one and 0 is connected with 28. So 28 and 16, 16 is less, so we connect 2 to 1, then from 1 to 6, because this is 14 and 1 to 0 is 28. Okay. So if this is your minimum spanning tree and original, all these vertices are there in this minimum spanning tree and the total weight is minimum. So this is the one way to extract a minimum spanning tree from a given graph. Another one is Kruskal's algorithm. This algorithm says, if a given graph is there, arrange all these arcs in increasing order of the weights. For example, this is the arc from 0 to 5. From 0 to 5, weight is 10, this is the first. Then 2 to 3, this is one is the 2 to 3, weight is 12, 2 to 3. Then 1 to 6, 14, then 1 to 2, 16. So these, all these arcs or lines are arranged in increasing order of weights. That is a 10 weight, 12, then 14, 16 and so on. And then try to connect all these arcs and maintain the property of the tree. So now they are connecting first 0 to 5, from 0 to 5, and then 2 to 3, then they are connecting 2 to 3, then 1 to 6, then this is a 1 to 6, then 1 to 2, they are not connecting, sorry, then 1 to 2, 1 to 2 is this one, then 3 to 6, they are not connecting 3 to 6 because if you connect the 3 to 6, then there is a loop. It means this is violating the property of the tree. It means this you cannot connect 3 to 6, then leave this, again go to 3 to 4, then 3 to 4, then now 3 to 4 is this one, then 4 to 6, 4 to 6, you cannot connect, otherwise there is a loop. Then 4 to 5, then 4 to 5, there is no loop, then this is your complete and minimum spanning tree. The total weight is this one. So by these two methods, you can extract that particular minimum spanning tree for a given graph. Now another one problem is the Chinese postman problem. So here, actually, let us say this is your post office. So postman wants to move from this post office, and he wants to cover each and every street with a minimum travel distance. But minimum in the sense, if we want to move each and every street, it means he has to move at all these streets. So there is no concept of the minimum length, because his objective is to move on each and every line. But the question is, if these types of the networks are there, then he has to travel more, sometimes more than once on a single route. Then that is extra length he is traveling. So in this problem, our effort is if the postman is traveling on a single road more than one, then how we can, or let us say there are 2, 3, or 4, 5 ages over which the traveling postman is traveling more than once, then it means the total travel distance is more. So here our objective is how we can minimize the total extra length, not the length of this original graph. This, the length of the original graph is basically called the lower bound, and he has to travel sometimes more than once on a single road, and how we can minimize the total extra length. So thing is, if you draw a common path for this particular network, then you are not able to define a single route from starting point to individual street and then finally come back. For example, if a postman is going from here to here, then here to here, then here to here, then here to here, here, then here, then here. Now he has already traveled over there, he can go to back. It means he is just repeating the same path, and again he has to go here, then again repeating path, he has to go here, then again repeating path, here, then again repeating path, here, again repeating path, here, again repeating path, and then finally come back. It means the repetition is so much, and how we can minimize this repetition, that is also called the duplication, or in this sense you can say how we can minimize this repetition, or how we can minimize this extra travel length. So question is, how, why we are not able to define a single path from starting point to starting point covering all these lines once and only once? So question is, if this particular graph is not Eulerian, then you cannot define a single route from starting point to starting point. It means this graph is not Eulerian. Why it is not Eulerian? Eulerian, if graph is not linear, if all the vertices or few vertices are of odd degree. For example, degree is nothing but the number of connected line on a vertex. Let us say this vertex is connected with 3 lines. It means the degree of this vertex is 3. Similarly, the degree of this is 3. 3 means odd. It means these vertices are having odd degrees. It means this is non-Eulerian graph. So question is, if you are really interested to the get the solution of the postman problem, you first convert this non-Eulerian graph into Eulerian graph, and then if you are able to convert into Eulerian graph, then you can find out the solution of the postman problem, and the total travel time and distance will be minimum. For example, this one, if we are let us say we are repeating at this location and this location and this location, it means total travel length is, extra length is this one, 1, and this is basically the repetition or duplication. So this 3 is extra here, 9 is extra here. So if in this configuration you can find out a single route from starting point to starting point, let us say from here to here, then here to here, then here to here, then this, then this, then this, and then this, then this, this, then this, and then this, you can come back, then here, then here, then here. It means there is a single route from starting point to starting point. It means now it is Eulerian graph, or you can say all the vertices are having the even degrees. It means this is the solution, but the total extra length is not minimum. Best solution, it is not best solution. Is there any possibility? You can see here, if we don't connect this duplicacy, if we connect this way, this route and then this route, it means the degree of this will be even, degree of this will be even, and degree of this will be again even, and the total extra length will be this 2 plus 6, 8. Here the total extra length is 9. It means through this way, the total extra length is 8 is less than 9. It means that may be another solution, or which may be optimal. This one you can say, here the total extra length is 2 plus 8, 6, 8, 9, 9 plus 3, 12. Here the total travel extra length is 12, and in first configuration the total extra length was 13. So now 12 is less than 13. In this sense you can say this is optimal as compared to that one. There is another path. If you see, it's still not the best solution. Why it is not best solution? If you are connecting in this way, means from here to here, and then from here to here, then from here to here. So the total extra length is, this one is 2, and this one is 3. So 2 plus 3, 5, and plus 2, 7. So now the total extra length is 7. Earlier it was 8. It means 7 is less than it. So this is the best solution. So by this way you can find out the solution of the Chinese postman problem. These are the few steps, whatever we have discussed, all these steps are written in this form. And this is the maximum flow problem. Basically this is the capacitated problem, and the capacity of each and every line is given, and then you can define the path, different path, augmenting path from source to sink, and then accordingly we can find out the solution. So these are the some examples of the practicals, like a liquid flowing through pipes, you can manage the maximum flow, current through electric network, goods transported on the road, traffic flow through the roads. These are some applications of this particular problem. Information through the communication network and so on. Thank you.